that was fun. All right. So some of you have heard this story, some of you haven't, but we were in, where were we? I think we were in, where's the guy that plays the fiddle, the Kentucky bluegrass guy that, you know, and his son. Anyway, we were somewhere, and Joanne McFadden was leading worship, and I was loving it. And I told Cheryl, I said, someday she's going to be a worship leader at Glad Tidings. And she said, Cheryl said, you're just saying that because you really love her worship leading. I said, no, I really love her worship leading, and I'm saying that because someday she'll be a worship leader at Glad Tidings. And then we got to know her, and God blessed us. But I want to say this about Joanne McFadden. I love Joanne McFadden so much. And there's a lot of reasons. She's a wonderful person. But several years ago, how long have you been here?
7.5 years.
7.5 years. Oh, my goodness. Anyway, about 7.5 years ago, I was going through a really tough time spiritually. And the more you're involved in the kingdom of God, the less you sweat natural pressures, natural things that are happening, and the more sensitive you are to spiritual pressures and spiritual things that are happening. But I was going through a really, really tough time. And she came, and God blessed us. She moved here. We started doing these, we called it Joanne Oakley and the Posse. And we started doing these times where we'd just go Friday, Saturday, and Sunday and worship the Lord. And Joanne is not just a great musician, but she's prophetic, which means she senses things that the Spirit of God is saying and doing. And then a lot of times she sings those out. And we have amazing stories of how God used her in that way. But in any event, she prophesied over me and in song, and I recorded those, and I'd sometimes get away and listen for hours and hours and hours. I just listened to her singing prophetically, and so she sang me through some of the darkest seasons of my life, really hard times. Things were happening in the spirit realm. And I will be forever grateful to you for that. So anyway, we've been talking about tonight, trying to find an easy way to do this, and there's really no easy way. But anyway, Joanne's going to give you an update on her life. And so here is the one and only Little Miss Sure Shot, Joanne Oakley, Sister Hare. Let's hear it for her.
So funny. I'll tell the true version of that story. He started calling me Joanne Oakley because he has a version that it just, I'm sorry, but liars go to hell, Dave. But anyway, there's this, it was the first time I was here. And it was Sunday, and Dave was dropping me off. We'd done a service, a weekend of service. I didn't live here yet. And anyway, he was dropping me off at the hotel after the service and lunch. And I said, well, what are you going to do? Because I was there till Monday morning. It's like, you're just going to dump me in the hotel and take off, you know? He said, well, kind of looking at me like a little bit like, is it your business? But he said he's going to go shoot guns with some guys. And I said, and you didn't invite me? And he says, you want to shoot guns? I said, yeah, I like shooting guns. And so he said, well, come on, girl. And I went upstairs and changed, and we went out there. I thought it was maybe 7-8 guys he was getting together with, and it was 60 guys, I think. And they did this thing where it was shooting lead and breaking bread. It was a fellowship with guys. And so I went out there, and they had, you know, all these guns lined up on these big long tables and all this ammo, and you could shoot at the targets and all that stuff. So Everybody was doing that, and guy comes out with a 50 millimeter. Can I say this stuff? Is this okay? Huh? I know, but it's okay to talk about this? Okay. I just had this thought, maybe, you know, the thing, what happens in Vegas stays in Vegas, but anyway, it was a 50 caliber, big gun. And so, yeah, sniper rifle, something they, I think, put on tanks for the snipers and that kind of thing. But anyway, they were going to let one person take the shot because everybody wanted to see it happen. And so they cleared the table off and they were, you know, setting it up. And Dave says, I think our guest of honor should take the shot. You know, and I, well, that was not my reaction to that. I sideways, I just kind of went over to him and I said, Dave, every guy here is foaming at the mouth to take this shot. And they're all thinking you're going to waste it on a girl. And so then he goes, yeah, our guest of honor should take, she'll take the shot. And I'm just thinking, help me, Jesus. So they set it all up. But they filled this water thing with, what was it? It wasn't an ice chest, just a water chest, but a round thing with a pop top. So they filled that up, it's about that big, and they set it out there, I don't know how far, and so I had to take the shot. And I'm just saying, Jesus help me, because if I don't make this, they're gonna all just think, yeah, we wasted it on a girl. So I took the shot and hit it, and the way it hit, it went up in the air and it burst in two, and the pop top went one way and the water shot up and 60 guys were going, yeah, you know, like that. And I was going, thank you, God, thank you, God. So that's how Annie Oakley came to be. Anyway, fond memories here, many fond memories here. And so this is hard for me because Michael and I are moving, and we're not going to be in a part of another ministry or church or anything like that. I don't think I could find one like this. This has been a very safe place for us, and I appreciate your love. And I appreciate how you've embraced us here, myself and Michael, and all your prayers and, you know, well, that was our evidence of the shot. That was a big old gun. I'll tell you, though, that's the sweetest shot I ever took. I am not kidding. I didn't know what other word to use it. It was so, it was just sweet. It was so smooth, and the bullet was like that long, and I'm not exaggerating. But anyway, yeah, so it's not like we're going to be a part of anything else. It's just, I've had a vision for years of doing a what would be called a wellness / creativity center, and it would include some natural therapies and prayer and worship, and then setting up buildings where people could come and try their hand at creative things and just find out what their creativity is, because God put creativity in us. You know, if you're an accountant, God could put creativity in you for how you do all your numbers, you know, and that kind of stuff. Creativity is in every single person. It's not just an artistic expression that we would consider artistic. Some of the most beautiful artistic things have to do with science. And when I've read a lot about quantum physics, and that's one of the most beautiful things I've ever delved into. And there's some really good books on God and heaven and the Bible and quantum physics and how it all fits together, how God created this realm, how he created the spirit realm, and he created them to interface and to uphold each other, and then created us as a being to be able to be in both realms, I believe, at all times. And so it's just getting back to the place that God originally intended for us to do and how to walk with him. And so that's been a journey for me for about 25 years or so. And, you know, when I first started talking about it, I got a lot of backlash. I mean, a lot. She's New Age. She's a witch. She's, you know, from all kinds of weird stuff. From people who've never even had a conversation with me. So, you know, it's like, let's just talk, you know. I'm not trying to defend myself, but let's just have a conversation here. And so I've never Googled my name, and I never will, because I don't want to know what people are saying. You know, you don't need to believe the press about yourself, good or bad. You just be with the Lord. But anyway, I knew there was something. I knew God was trying to teach me some things about light and sound and how all of that works together. And then Neville Johnson has talked about some things when he was seeing in the spirit realm for months at a time, and how he would see the color that was coming off of people when they emitted certain emotions, and when they would give themselves to that, then the demonic would actually hear the frequency that was of the emotion that was coming off the person, see the color of light, and so he was hearing the sound, seeing the light, and smelling a fragrance or a stench that was coming off of them, and they would flock to it. And if it was a demonic thing, like if it was a negative thing, say they were very angry, he said he could see this dirty brownish red coming off of them, and it was a stench that he could smell. The Lord did this to him for about 4 months, and he said he was begging God to take it away because it was really too much to walk in that all the time. But he said, and the demonic then would flock to that. They would hear it, sense it, see the color, smell the stench, and that would draw them, and then they would feed into it, and they would feed off of it. And he would watch the person get angrier and angrier as they gave themselves to it, and just seeing some principles about how the spirit realm works. And he said, but interesting, if the person stopped and realized, what am I doing, you know, getting angry like this? I need to forgive what's going on. And they would actually stop the emotion, get a hold of themselves, and release and forgive, the demonic would just go away. Because I think it's like the scripture where Jesus said, Satan has come to sift me, and he found nothing in me. So there was nothing for him to grab hold of. So even if we initially have those emotions, if we will get a hold of that, and ask God to help us, release that and walk out from, even just take a step out from, out of it. I don't want to be in that place. He said that same thing worked for the, even for the angelic. You know, if love and peace and forgiveness and all of the good attributes of God were taking place in a person's heart, he saw the angelic flock to that. And so that's why I think in the scripture where it says that where two or three are gathered in my name, there I will be also. We can just always be guaranteed of that, you know, that he is going to be there. I remember years ago I was in Kansas City for 20-some years with Mike Bickle, and we would have prayer meetings. We had them three times a day back then before IHOP, and he was walking into the prayer room, and he literally, with his open eyes, saw the sky part, and he heard angels singing, and he was just, you know, undone by that. And he's thinking, this is it. This is the prayer meeting. God's coming, you know. So it was a just a... mediocre prayer meeting. we did like 45 minutes of prayer, and then we would do of worship, and then we would do 45 minutes of prayer. And the worship was really hard and dry. And he's thinking, well, it must be the prayer then, you know. And the prayers were hard and dry, like, you know, you were more depressed when you left than you were when you went in. And that kind of thing where you're looking at your watch, it's only been 5 minutes. And so, you know, it was that kind of a meeting. And he was just so confused and asked God, you know, I don't get it. You know, what were you telling me or showing me? And he said, I just wanted you to see what happens every single time you gather, whether you feel it or not. You know, so we don't go by our feelings. But it's interesting how the natural realm and the spiritual realm, they actually coincide and intermingle with each other and support each other, and then we operate within that he gave us. But, you know, that's just a little freebie thing there. But that's just some of the trail, the hunt that he's had me on. I love the scripture that talks about it's the glory of God to hide a matter, the glory of a king to search the matter out. And so I love the searching out and the mysteries of God. You know, I just love searching out the mysteries of God, to know God more, to know what he thinks, to know, you know, so much he's laid out there in scripture that we can kind of know how he thinks and know how he works. And what we've been taught, in at least for me, in a religious upbringing, I thank God for some of the principles that I got in that kept me out of a lot of trouble. But at the same time, it kept me apart from God, because I always felt like something was wrong with me and I wasn't good enough. And even though I never did anything and just wanted to always be at church, but I still thought he was mad at me and waiting to hit me over the head. And I didn't know until we ended up going to Mike Bickle's church, when he was preaching on Passion for Jesus. And he taught Song of Solomon over and over and over, and the wooings of God upon us, and how he really feels about us. It's the kindness of God that brings us to repentance. And yeah, there's judgment in the scripture and that kind of thing, but that's not, I don't think that's God's heart. That's not what he wants. He chooses to draw near to us as we draw near to him. He chooses kindness. If we turn away from the kindness, then because he loves us, then other things enter in. But you know, just all the attributes of who he is, and all the mysteries, and I love that. And it's my, obviously, well, for those of you who have been here through the years, it comes into my worship, just a pursuit of, as a people, you know, that it's in our hearts to know God and to feel his presence. And that's what I've so loved here, that we've been able to be a part of, is feeling his presence and knowing his love and the hunger and the desire for God just to have his way, regardless of what it looks like, regardless of what we look like. Just have your way, and let this be a place that your presence and your love resides. And I've so loved that about this place, and everybody's very kind and loving, and Dave and Cheryl have been so supportive and loved me, and Paul and Mary have been by my side so many times, and Dwayne and Juanita, and I don't want to start Andrew and Eunice. I don't want to start naming names because I'll leave somebody out, but just the love that we've seen and experienced here. And it started several months ago, and somebody mentioned to me about moving to South Carolina, and my natural response was, are you kidding me? It's humid there. This hair doesn't live in humidity. It doesn't reside in humidity. It's big enough. And so, I just kind of laughed it off. And then a couple of weeks later, my sister calls me and says, "We've bought a house in South Carolina, and I think you're supposed to move here." And I said, "Uh-huh." show me your house, show me pictures, and get her off the topic of us moving there, because I was like, that's not going to happen. And so she kept at it, and so I actually flew out there. My intent was to land, she would pick me up, it would be humid, and I would say, heck no. I'd probably would have said, hell no, I'm not moving into this humidity, this is not happening, let's go eat, so, but it actually wasn't all that humid, and so the house I was supposed to look at, that I was going to tell her no to, had sold, and so the next day we met with the realtor, and she took us to a house that was on 26 acres, had a couple of ponds, it's a big old farmhouse, and with the tall ceilings and the molding and all that stuff that's always been a dream to me, with wide hallways and wide doorways for Michael, which he's was very happy about. And anyway, I actually stepped onto the property and knew I was home. And I felt safe. Well, that was very important to me because it's been a long time since I really felt really safe, and I did here. And I was leaving the safety of the relationships and the love and the presence of God here, like God telling Abraham to go, just go. And I felt I was home, and I felt safe, and it was very peaceful. And then I went into the house, and she had been she was an antique dealer, and her daughter was a interior design person, and so they had made this house really beautiful. And I thought, wow, because I'd had words and from lots of people, I'd had this dream of this center, and it needed to be on land like that. It needed to be a place of peace and rest, and because the theme of it is He restores my soul. And so I felt that when I was there, and I just thought, wow, God, this is, kind of slapping me upside the head of, really? And so I slept on it. And first of all, she took me to a couple other places, and I just said, I'm wasting your time. I said, that first place we went to, that's my house. That's my land. And I don't need to see anything else. And so I went to bed that night and prayed, and everything worked out. Come to find out, the couple that owned it were Christians. They were in their 80s, and they had moved there to do a very similar thing. And, she was an organic gardener. They had well water. They had meetings there for people. Across the road, directly across the road, is the Cowboy Church. They have a rodeo once a year. I thought, wow, you can come visit for the rodeo. But anyway, long story short, that is where we're going, and that's what we're doing. And it's not, we're not affiliating with another ministry or church. It's just to bring this center to fruition that is been in my heart, and I've had many words about it through the years. And to be honest, I was at the point where I had just about given up on it. Land was too expensive here, and the laws are difficult to do that kind of thing, natural alternative healing. So it was would be very difficult to do it here. Even though I thought, well, maybe once we get the ranch up, maybe we'll, you know, do that, make that part of it. But anyway, this happened, and I know God's voice when he's leading me, and he's leading us to South Carolina. Surprise, surprise to me and to Michael, and my sister lives there, so she'll be helping, and I think Benito is going to end up out there. So here I am, 64, starting this thing, and I've got all these acres, and I'm thinking, I don't know what to do, God. This is, really? Like, how do I do this, you know, of all this land? And my brother-in-law's friend from work came to me, and he said, a buddy of mine, they're Christians, and he said, a buddy of mine, we want to be caretakers of your land in exchange to hunt and fish on your property. I said, what? He said, yeah, like we can hunt deer and fish in your ponds because that's good black water. I guess it's good fishing water. And we'll take care of the land for you. And I was undone by that because that was a big deal for me. That was a very big deal for me. And, you know, it's been hard just leaving what's here and the people that are here. And Crystal Meeks has been so intricate in our lives and helping me with Michael and being such a friend and a supporter. And but I prayed about it, and the Lord said, you know, it's just you and Michael going. And then I need some help with video stuff and computer stuff and things to do with my business. And the Lord brought somebody who was every single thing that I asked for. And she's also done caretaking, so she'll be helping with Michael. So it's just right and left. The Lord is filling every need that there is. And my brother-in-law and his brother are fixing things that need to be fixed and getting a bathroom that works for Michael in his room. And I mean, I'm undone by the faithfulness of God and how he is proven himself to me in this, and just said, I'm with you in this. This is me. And he's done it in several very big ways. So I don't doubt, which that's helped me, because there have been many times I woke up in the morning and thought, what are you doing? You know, and kind of being gripped even by fear. And so he's been very good and very gracious to fill the need there. So that's it. That's what we're going to go do. And we'll be back. We'll be back. When we do the
promise?
Oh, yes.
Every year?
Of course.
Maybe twice a year, maybe?
Sure. Okay. Yeah, we have our worship things that we're doing. So. Right. Oh.
So, if there's anything I have confidence in, it's John McFadder's ability to hear the voice of the Lord. And I learned a long time ago, we need to have confidence and take joy in the will of God. And that's true whether people are coming to us or going from us. The will of God is always a good thing. So, yeah, come on up, Michael. And here he comes, driving his chariot furiously. Anyway, we so love Joanne McFadder and Michael, and we'll miss you, but do promise to come back. And I'm going to take you up on that rodeo. You tell me when that rodeo is. Come back there. And so these for you, ma'am. Just a token of our love. And also, there's a little gift in here that'll be just good for you to wear around your neck and remember us. And so you can look at that when you get a chance. But I want us all to stand up. And Joanne, let's go down there and just stand by Michael. We want to gather around you and bless you and just remind you how dearly we love you. And we'll be praying for the success of your venture. Everybody stand up. Anybody who wants to come, just join us, gather around them. And we love them, love them, love them. They'll always be in our hearts. So just extend your hand toward them. We're going to bless them and pray over them. Lord Jesus, we thank you so much for Joanne McFadden and for Michael. Thank you for the way they've enriched this house and Lord, blessed us so deeply. We thank you for your kindness to share them with us for these last years. And Lord, we know that your will is good and perfect and pleasing in every way. And as they move on into the next exciting chapter in the book of their lives, we do pray your blessing over them in Jesus' name. Bless them, keep them. Thank you, Lord, that you've already just confirmed your love and care for them and all the details that have worked out and all of your provisions. We thank you for that, Lord. You are the one who sees the need in advance and provides. And so we bless them, and we thank you for them, and we pray for great, great grace for them. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so we're going to give you all a chance to hug them and do whatever you need to do to say your goodbyes. Anyway, thanks for coming out tonight. Love you a lot. The cafe is open. If you're a guest, remember to stop by there and get a free worship CD and coffee or whatever you want. All right, God bless you. Thanks. Bye-bye.